county and its surrounding communities the opportunity to hear from progressive candidates and leaders whose voices, because of their unconventional qualities, tend to be marginalized and muffled by the more mainstream political candidates and leaders. And as with all of Essex Rising's events, the Progressive Talk series is part of a comprehensive effort to resist the divisive Donald J. Trump agenda. So today, in part one of our series, we present to you the Green Party New Jersey candidate for governor, the Honorable Mr. Seth Kaper-Dale. Now, without stealing any of Mr. Kaper-Dale's thunder, I just want to explain, you know, very quickly why we chose Mr. Kaper-Dale as our first progressive talker. Now, first, the Green Party's national platform has 10 key values that are nearly an exact replica of Essex Rising's principles. And those key values are 1, grassroots democracy, 2, social justice and equal opportunity, 3, ecological wisdom, 4, nonviolence. And just as an aside, I rarely hear any of our mainstream candidates talking about nonviolence. And the Green Party is all about promoting nonviolence. 5, decentralization, which includes restructuring our social, political, and economic institutions away from a system controlled by and mostly benefiting the powerful few to a democratic, less bureaucratic system. 6, community-based economics. 7, feminism and gender equality. 8, respect for diversity. 9, personal and global responsibility. And 10, future focus and sustainability, where our actions and policies should be motivated by long-term goals. Finally, we chose Mr. Kaper-Dale because he promotes those 10 values on a regular basis. He promises to uphold them if elected governor, and I hear he's a really nice person. So without any further ado, I present to you Mr. Seth Kaper-Dale.
Hi, everyone.
Hi.
You think I need a microphone, or should I just
keep
it on? All right.
Yes.
Perfect. Perfect. Then I'll do that. It's a great opportunity to be here today, and I love the fact that this group has risen up after Donald Trump's presidency, and I think that one of the things that I'm noticing just from the various forms of resistance out there right now is that it's going to take sitting and talking and being wise together and not just rallying to be able to sustain resistance for these 4 years. So I think it's wise to be getting together to talk together, to listen to people who are attempting to have a role in the new political climate, etc. So I want to tell you about myself and then about my platform for governor. But many of you have never heard me speak and don't know anything about me, and that's exciting for me. My wife and I are co-pastors of the Reformed Church of Highland Park. We have been pastors of a church for 15 years, and I think for some people, hearing that I'm a pastor doesn't necessarily mean that I have any qualifications whatsoever to be an administrator. So I need to tell you what it means that I've been a pastor. I entered a church that had 35 people in it 15 years ago. It now has 500 members and 3,500 people a week in the building. I had a church that had a tiny budget of $150,000 a year. Now we have nearly $2 million of activity that happen in and through the church on an annual basis through all the social justice programs that we run. We had no nonprofits other than the church itself. We now have started a handful of nonprofits, and each of those nonprofits has substantial programs that exist under it, and I'll tell you about those things. Diversity in my church was 34 white people and 1 black guy married to a white woman. That was 15 years ago. Now there's 50 countries represented through first-generation immigrants, as well as tremendous racial and ethnic diversity from within the United States. So our world has changed in those 15 years. We've taken a small sort of inconsequential congregation, not for the people who are worshiping there, but in terms of its input and engagement in the world, we turned it into something fairly major for Central New Jersey. Some of the things that we've that we've done. We created the Form Church of Highland Park Affordable Housing Corporation. Our first project was to put a housing complex for women aging out of foster care on the roof of our church, believing that we ought to be a YIMBY community, a yes in my backyard community. And that was our way not only to show that faith communities could have a role in correcting the tremendous problems of affordable housing in the state of New Jersey, but also a way to speak about the larger issues of COA and Mount Laurel agreements and all the failures of so many wealthy apartheid-like towns in New Jersey that have managed to tie up affordable housing in the courts since 1976 over and over again, making sure that actually we don't get anywhere in terms of really making our communities economically diverse. So that was our first project. I was pushing against the Iraq war for the first many years that I was pastor. My first Sunday, by the way, was the Sunday before 9/11. And eventually we decided to start a program. If we could spend billions to kill, we could spend millions to put people back together. And we created All Saints Apartments for homeless veterans. We bought an abandoned church. We gutted that church and turned it into 11 apartments for homeless veterans as a form of resistance to the broken world and the ways of war that were ravaging the world and that we felt we needed to take a stand for. Since then, we have gone issue after issue and related it to housing. We have housing for folks coming out of prison who have been accepted through the Mountain View program and are studying at Rutgers. They started their degree in prison and are finishing it now outside, and we own a house where 5 of those students live. We've bought houses in Newark and in Brunswick, 2 in each, for chronically homeless, mentally ill adults. We have housing in Newark for youth with justice involvement who also have a mental health diagnosis and have experienced homelessness, one on Hawthorne Street and one on Brill Street. We have housing for asylees and refugees, and in many of those cases, we are actually renting. My congregation's Affordable Housing Corporation becomes the tenant, and then we sublease to refugees coming out of a camp in Uganda who cannot show a credit history, cannot show that they're going to get a job easily, have none of the things it takes to get housing. We say we're guaranteeing that they will be good tenants, and we're putting the onus of responsibility on ourselves as the tenant and subleasing. And so we've had tremendous opportunity to impact people at the bottom of society economically and otherwise, to help them move forward. We also started Who Is My Neighbor, Inc.? And that is, we ask that question, who are our neighbors and how can we serve them? And through that program, we started a fair trade store in Highland Park that eventually led 10,000 villages to open a corporate store in our town. We then started a cafe called, the first one was called the Better World Cafe. It was about environmental responsibility, 50-mile meals, everything was grown locally, and everyone could eat. One world, everyone eats. Now we have closed that cafe and started a new cafe called Global Grace Cafe. And all of the chefs are asylees and refugees from around the world. Indian food on Monday, Syrian food Tuesday and Wednesday, Congolese food on Thursday, Indonesian food on Friday, and Sierra Leonean soups every day of the week. So these are the kinds of things that creative, thoughtful people are doing in Highland Park. Through all of that, and I won't keep going on to the other things we've done, but through all of that, what I have learned is that I'm a good administrator. I encourage people. People enjoy working for me. Their ideas and their dreams become reality. We never operate from a place of like it's impossible or there's not enough money. We believe that if there's something that needs to be done to make the world a more just and loving place, it can be done. And that kind of attitude has led to tremendous changes in our community. I would say that it's led to beauty. And to me, beauty is the most important word in the world, that everyone gets an opportunity to experience the beauty of this earth and to live here in peace and with the things they need to thrive. So that's kind of a bit about myself. One of the things that's happened throughout my time as pastor and as I've started all these different nonprofits is I've become deeply frustrated by the systems in place that keep poverty going, that keep violence going, that keep us oppressed as a state. And so at some point, I made the decision to say, I no longer want to just throw stones at tanks. It's always good to throw stones at tanks. But I don't only want to throw stones at tanks. Eventually, there are moments when you have to say, you got to stop the tank. And you got to step into the tank and beat that tank into plowshares and pruning hooks, to steal an Old Testament prophet line. But really, to say that you can't just keep going in a world where you let these things run rampant and then spend our time at the end of a stream, cleaning up the mess that's made upstream. So that's why I'm running for governor. I feel that we have for way too long allowed a two-party duopoly of corporate parties to make the decisions about how our world is shaped. And I no longer want to live in that kind of world. I don't want to live in the kind of world where we have to fight so hard to stop solitary confinement in our jails because somehow there's a benefit to somebody to have solitary confinement. I don't want to live in a world where we are giving people a dollar a day while they're working inside jail and some private corporation is making money off their labor. That reminds me too much of indentured servitude for slavery. I don't want to live in that kind of world where drug laws are drawn up, not because cannabis is such an awful thing, but because a whole lot of people can make a whole lot of money and keep a certain portion of the population down if we could create the kind of energy, negative energy, to say cannabis is something that should lead to locking people up and into the kind of drug wars that have plagued this country for so long. So I want to step into a place of leadership and break that system up. A few years ago when I stepped into the voter booth, the ballot box, and it was Chris Christie versus Barbara Bono. And I stepped in that morning knowing that really it was only Chris Christie. That 60 elected Democrats had publicly endorsed Chris Christie after 4 years of the ways he had brutally attacked public teachers, gone after unions, and just created a negative spirit around our state. Undone environmental things like the RGGI agreements, the Regional Energy Greenhouse Gas Initiative. The fact that 60 elected Democrats, including like big ones like Joey D, had come out in favor of Chris Christie, I just thought, okay, there's two horses in the race, and we're told that this is the only way the world works. And yet there's really only one horse in the race, because the folks who are supposed to be supporting the Democrat horse have decided it's better for their special interests this time to line up with the Republican. So that was the moment I said, if I ever run for governor, I will not run as a Democrat in the state of New Jersey. There may be other states where there is such a thing as a progressive Democrat. But in the state of New Jersey, the party is so corrupt, it's so deeply corrupt, and the party bosses have so much power that we have to clean house entirely. Maybe someday there could be a progressive Democratic Party in the state again. But at this moment, the party is still owned by a handful of people. And so that's why I decided if I ever run for governor, I will run as a third-party candidate, and I will run to win, and I won't worry for one moment what it means about the overall picture. They need to worry about what it means for the overall picture. That's not my responsibility. This is the world we live in. So the stars lined up, and it became possible for me to run for governor this year. When Phil Murphy was suddenly endorsed back in October as the candidate of choice by all the party bosses before any other candidate had even gotten their name, you know, into the ring yet, that was sort of confirmation of my concerns, and my wife said, this is not going away, this itch to run for governor, I think you better do it. And so with her blessing, I decided to step into this. I did not know when I began exactly what my central issues would be. What I knew is that I had a lens called the last or first lens that I would put over every decision that I would think about as governor. And I hold that still as the central piece of my campaign. The last or first doesn't mean that it only matters, you know, only the needs of those at the bottom matter. But it means we need to start all decision making by thinking of who's last in any particular scenario. And have that be the decision. Instead of the first being first, as it always seems to be, the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. So I try not to Bible quote too much because some people can't deal with that, but to me, that's a pretty good one. The last shall be first, and the first shall be last. And that is the direction of the way I think about decision-making administratively when I think about being governor in the state of New Jersey. So when I think about who are the people I worry about the most in the state, the first three groups that come to mind can't vote for me. The first is children. Children in the state of New Jersey have been last. There's something like 438,000 children who live in households that bring in less than $35,000 a year. Given the cost of housing, the cost of food, the cost of everything in this state, it's near impossible to feel any sense of security in a household like that. And yet a tremendous portion of our kids are living in that kind of poverty. When I think about kids, I think about the way that we've allowed a school system to work where we have some schools that rate really high on scores, and they tend to be the richest and whitest towns in New Jersey. And then we have some of the scores in other towns that are the poorest and the most heavily minority communities in our state. And the serious problems we have with our public school system. One, we don't fund it enough. The courts told us in 2009 that there was a funding formula we were to live by. It hasn't been funded even one time. Some people say the first year it was funded fully, but I've read enough articles on this to believe it actually wasn't. So it's not been funded fully, and yet you hear people saying the funding formula is broken, change the whole thing around. I say, don't you dare change the funding formula until you've tried it once. And let's operate from a place of strength instead of weakness when it comes to changing funding formulas. When I think of kids, I think of the fact that the Mount Laurel agreements, as I mentioned earlier, never were really lived into, and that COA has always gotten a bad name, and that towns have pushed so hard to keep from having affordable housing built in their town. And I think about how that plays out in terms of schools, and we often operate like these are two different tracks altogether. But if we had been faithful to building affordable housing, hundreds of thousands of units, probably close to 1 million units by now, have been deferred as towns have tied up in court their expectation for their town. How would that have changed what public school would have looked like for kids for this past generation? And what would it mean now? So we need to come clean on the ways that we've built an unjust society through our housing practices and our underfunding of schools. And now we complain, gosh, we're giving all that money to these cities that can't do well by their kids. I say, wait a minute. You're forgetting the history that got us into the mess that we're in, and we need to be careful with that. I also am concerned the way that charter schools have become a wedge issue. Early on, I was just like anti-charter, 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 and I am very much for a moratorium on charters. I'm for democratic control of charters, that school boards need to be elected. But it was by meeting with black families and having some people who I care a lot about say to me, Seth, until you tell me you wouldn't send your kid to the charter next door if you didn't believe in the public school in your area, I don't want you to say another like definitive statement about charters without being a little bit more thoughtful to why it is that we have the situation with charters that we're in. It really stopped me in my tracks and made me say, let's be careful. Let's not turn this into a wedge issue. Let's get to a place where we fully fund public education, not steal dollars from the public school to go to charters, but let's just get away from letting people who are fighting for crumbs fight each other when really the problem that exists is that the system in place has got us going at each other in this way when really there's plenty of money out there to support a lot of opportunity. So, Jeff?
No, I think you're 5 more minutes.
Okay, all right. let me just take a sip of the coffee. So, I could go on and on about the different, as I mentioned, children. The next thing would be folks in prison. Mass incarceration, not only in this state, but across this country, is out of control. And so those would be some of my first priorities as governor, would be to try to work with assembly members and senators who want to push legislation to change some laws about what happens in prison. The first is that a person is a person is a person, and no one should ever lose the right to vote. And I think the fact that we allow people to have their humanity taken away through losing their vote it's like losing a fundamental thing. There's no reason on earth why that's connected to a prison term. So I want folks who are in jail to be voting about the school board in the town they're from. I want them to count as a full human being in the town where they last lived with a permanent address before going into prison, as opposed to suddenly being on the rolls for living in Salem County when they've been in Essex their whole life, which is what happens right now when the census occurs. Salem County gets to count all those folks who can't vote as living in their county, Cumberland County. It's to me a crime. I want to make sure that if there are folks locked up who have children on the outside, that they have the opportunity to pay child support on the outside through jobs on the inside that allow them to make a minimum wage where they can be kicking into their family's economic future. There's no reason we can't think about these things. People are doing work already, and if we really believe in reentry and in restoration, we ought to be building people's dignity up, and that can start on the inside. The third category that I always think of that can't vote for me, but who I care deeply about, is undocumented immigrants. And if you've ever heard my name at all, you've probably heard it in relation to standing on behalf of undocumented immigrants. immigrants and standing up with people whose families are being broken up. It's been a huge commitment on my life. One of the biggest things was an 11-month period where 9 individuals lived in my building, all who had ankle monitors on their legs and were supposed to have gotten on airplanes, and instead we moved them into our church and basically built a sanctuary of protection around those individuals and their families. And that worked really well until this past month, where 4 of those individuals were picked up by Donald Trump's minions and sent off to Indonesia and left their U.S. citizen kids and the DACA kids here. So I'm committed to New Jersey becoming a sanctuary. I am committed to going beyond the protective things, like we won't sign a 287G agreement and other things, but actually getting much more into resistance, such as I want to encourage and maybe pass some sort of legislation to have every municipality utilize its NICSEL alert system to alert our communities when ICE is breaking up families, when ICE is engaged in operations within communities. We tell people right now if there's a water main break on Fifth Avenue, why can't we tell them that ICE is engaged in our community? And people then can use their discretion to know, I'm not going out today, or I'm going there with my video camera, or I'm going to stay clear of Fifth Ave. And we're not telling people how they need to react in that situation, but we're information sharing about the work of a very, very dangerous arm of the federal government that's operating in our town in ways that I call are the operations of racial and ethnic cleansing American style. That's what the immigration system has become. We have a bias president who's become the hate crime president. When you connect bias with executive orders like the one from January 25th called the Security of the Interior, you have something very dangerous. Anyone other than our president would go to jail for connecting bias to a program to carry out dangerous things against people based on that bias. And that's what we have right now, and we can't accept it. I won't tell you more about specific issues. I'll let you ask me those questions. But the 3 biggies that I now see as the centerpiece of my campaign, which will allow us to have the money to do all the things that I believe need to happen for the commons, are these. The first is single-payer Medicare for all. When I got started with this, I honestly did not know if it was possible at the state level to make single-payer work. I didn't know enough about it all. I just knew that I'd love Bernie Sanders because for the first time I heard a real idea for how we could have single-payer Medicare for all in this country. Cradle to grave, improve Medicare for everyone. It all makes so much sense, and it made sense both on the human right of healthcare, but also it made tremendous economic sense. It made sense for everyone except those who are making a mint off the health insurance industry. And sometimes you have to attack an industry if an industry is hurting a nation. And so I'm not afraid at all to say the health insurance agency needs to be taken down as it is right now if we're going to be set free from it. So I didn't know if it would work at the state level. I've spent a lot of time talking to people who know a lot about this, and I am now completely convinced that New Jersey could be the state, if we can get ahead of New York and California, they're also moving this direction right now, but we could be the state that shows that this could set us economically free, and it could provide the tremendous health care that everyone deserves. There should not be a two-tier system where the Medicaid is for poor people and other stuff is for people who are better off. You should never have a case where someone can't get mental health services because they're on Medicaid because the reimbursements are so pitifully low. We shouldn't be in a place where people have to be cut off at 28 hours rather than working full-time because that employer doesn't want to have to take on another health insurance plan that they can't afford. You could work 40 and not worry at all. We shouldn't be in a place where employers are afraid to go up to $15 an hour minimum wage because they don't know what the health insurance is going to look like next year within their large business or their small business. I mean, we could really set things free if we went to single-payer Medicare for all. There's a lot more to say on that, and I can answer your questions later as we go through. The second topic is public banking. And this is one where currently I agree with the Democrat who was selected on Tuesday. I think public banking is a wonderful idea. At the moment, when we take a dollar and we put it into a Wall Street bank, that $1 becomes $10. And that $10 gets used to loan out money all around the globe for whatever pipeline, for whatever new mine in the Philippines or Honduras or whatever clear cutting in Brazil makes the most money for multinational corporations. We are contributing our money to the destruction of the world. That's what we're contributing to right now as a state. Rather than doing that, how about if every every dollar we put into our taxes got deposited into a bank in the state of New Jersey that became $10 to fix our mass transit system, $10 to lead us to a renewable energy future, $10 to offer low interest loans to university students who would already be paying less, by the way, because with Medicare for All, university tuition will go down dramatically. I've looked at this, it actually, the state covers most of the costs at Rutgers, for example, of the healthcare plan, but because they're doing that, they're not kicking much into tuition. If they didn't have to be paying for those incredibly expensive health insurance plans, and instead they were contributing to the single payer plan, there would be so much more money available to put toward tuition than we'd be seeing lower tuitions anyway. The third topic is progressive taxation. In our state, there's only 7 brackets in our tax plan. And once you're making $500,000 a year, you pay 8.9 or so percent the rest of the time, even if you're making $20 million a year. In other states, there are continual gradual increases. So when you hit $750,000, that amount between $500,000 and $750,000 is at one rate, and $750,000 to a million is another rate, million to a million and a half is another rate, and it goes on and on. In California, there are 13 brackets. We used to be one of the states that demanded the most from those who make inordinate sums of money. We are now dropping dramatically, something like from number 4th to number 13th in terms of what we expect from the wealthiest, and yet we are a state that has incredible wealth. The state always claims that it's broke, it always blames everything on waste, and I'm not saying that there isn't waste and stuff that needs to be improved, but I find when we jump to the question of waste being the first problem, and we need to, you know, fix this here, fix that there, it's often an avoidance tactic to say what really needs to happen. The big problem in the state of New Jersey is we're not demanding that the extremely wealthy people contribute more than what they're contributing right now. So I believe that those three things could help fund an economic revolution in the state, and it's going to take a revolution, not little soft reforms, which is what I feel at this moment is what the Democratic choice is about. I believe that's the thing that could change the state for the better. I think that's where I want to stop right now, and I want to take your questions.
Thank you so much. So, Mr. Kaper-Dale, I know that you have to leave in about 45 minutes, so I will I'll actually cut down on some of the questions that we actually asked two of the Democratic gubernatorial candidates about 2 months ago. We had a gubernatorial forum with Newsteed, thank you, and Jim Johnson. And so we asked them some questions, and they were prepared by the community, so I'm going to ask you the same questions. So the first question is this: the Democratic Party establishment, and let me just tell everybody, Mr. Kaper-Dale didn't know anything about these questions, so he is asking them, he's answering them, like right off the cuff. These are not prepared questions. So he's hearing them for the first time. So the Democratic Party establishment, including Senators Booker and Menendez, has already endorsed Bill Murphy, and he's won the Democratic primary, as we know. Why are you, Mr. Kaper-Dale, more deserving of their endorsement, and how can you compete against the Democratic Party establishment?
So I'm not more deserving of the endorsement of Cory Booker or Robert Menendez. I'm not more, I don't deserve their endorsement. I don't really want their endorsement. These are individuals who endorse the two-party duopoly. I honestly, they endorse one party of the two-party duopoly, and of course they would support Phil Murphy. Phil Murphy raised tremendous sums of money to put the current system in place that we have. He was supportive of all of the things that I don't stand for in terms of the domination of big money in government, and so I don't really want their endorsement. That's my answer.
Thank you.
I sure won't beg for it.
Now, what major impact on the state of New Jersey would you hope to have achieved by the end of your term?
So by the end of my term, I would want to have achieved single-payer Medicare for all in the state of New Jersey. And I know many people have said such things, and, you know, but I actually, people say it, but I don't think we've really given it a try at the state level. I mean, New York has a bill that has made it through the assembly one time. Colorado had a really good bill that unfortunately got taken down by the health insurance industry and by corporate parties in Colorado, I really believe. But I believe it can happen here. I like John Wisniewski's legislation. I need to study it more to see if there's ways that I would encourage it to be presented slightly differently. But on the whole, I think it looks like a pretty good bill. And I think that there is going to be a change in this state where people are going to start making the demands of their elected officials, Republican or Democrat or Green or anybody else, that single-payer Medicare for all makes sense. And you know, either the party establishment is going to have to come around on this one, or they're not going to be here for very long. So I actually cannot wait for the first moment when I can say to Phil Murphy, what are you going to do about single-payer Medicare for all? And just hammer him on that one. Because if he can't say that he's going to do New Jersey single-payer for all, then he really doesn't deserve to be in this race at this point. In the same way, if he can't say pipelines, there needs to be a moratorium on pipelines before we realize that we've set ourselves up for an energy future that's opposite of a renewable energy future. If he can't commit to that fully, then he can't get away with calling himself this environmental supporting candidate.
Can I ask an extension to that?
Absolutely.
What would you pay for it?
For single-payer Medicare for all. So single-payer Medicare for all would be a 6% tax on the employee and a 2% tax on the employer. And there would be some negotiations available on the 2% side. But the beauty of that is that for most people, that would be significantly less money as employers than they're already kicking in through the health insurance plans that they're paying currently. So we would see a dramatic reduction in the amount employers are kicking in, and yet it would still create enough money for us to have the most robust health care that we've ever had. So that's the main answer. There's all sorts of little answers, like small businesses that have never provided health insurance, suddenly they would have this to do. Well, most small businesses are paying for themselves, first of all. Their amount is going to go down dramatically. They're not having to buy an $18,000 plan for their family or whatever they're paying to get good health insurance. But also, the money saved through so many aspects of this will allow us to have some sort of a fund to assist small businesses in the move to single-payer Medicare for all.
But you're still keeping it tied into employment, though, through this tax.
It's tied into employment, yep.
Well, okay. Not for the individual, though.
Right. It's everybody, whether they're unemployed or that's the money that's going in for everybody. I should say that. This is no longer, your health care is no longer tied to your employer or to your employment. The way that the money is generated for all of us is through an employer and an employee contribution.
Okay. You said 6% for the employee and only 2%?
6% for the employer.
It's the other way around.
2%
okay.
For the employee. Did I say that backwards?
Yeah, you said it backwards.
Sorry about that. Thanks for clarifying.
Okay.
Thank you. So you kind of touched on the pipeline that runs through the state of New Jersey. Let me ask you a question about the environment. What is your... let me rephrase that. What will you do to protect the environment in New Jersey? As you're aware, there's a pipeline that runs through New Jersey. It includes, it goes through the sacred Lenape, Ramapo Lenape tribe land. It threatens, it threatens to contaminate the water supply. So what will you do to protect the environment of New Jersey as governor of New Jersey?
Thanks. Yeah, there's actually a whole web of pipelines, right? There's the pipelines that run under the pine lands that pipeline that was just approved by a commission that's supposed to be protecting the pine lands. Then there's the proposed Pilgrim pipeline that hasn't been approved yet, but is, there's always a threat that it would be. I want a moratorium on pipelines, period. I believe that until we are showing that we have any sort of a plan for a renewable energy future, we shouldn't be going backward by approving things that belong to the past. No, I'm all right. I've been fighting allergies and cold for a couple weeks now. So that's what I would say about pipelines. I'm also concerned about the increased capacity of existing pipelines. I know there's a pipeline right now that in Franklin is there's a big fight going on. They want to increase the capacity of an existing pipeline. We need to make sure that no new capacity come into play. I think I've heard right now that there's 60% more energy coming through New Jersey than could possibly be used by New Jerseyans on the day that would demand the most energy from us. And that's because we're just used as a pass-through to create energy for multinational corporations that you know need to get it to our ports and other places. So we really need to make sure that we stop that. It is contaminating our water. We also need to make sure that we start with the last or first mentality and look at the social justice issues connected with environmental justice and the ways that the water in Newark and New Brunswick and some other cities is actually more contaminated with lead than the waters of Flint, Michigan. Somehow, maybe it's because we have so few newspapers, we have not gotten that word out as well as we should in this state, that our water conditions are just horrific. So, yeah.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, the water in Newark is really bad.
We could go on to air quality, too, and pass on.
Absolutely. Okay, two more questions, and then I'm going to open the floor to the audience to ask questions and dialogue with you. What is your position on tax return disclosure for all public officials?
Yeah, well, I have to tell you that the day after Phil Murphy showed his $7.3 million made on interest income and investment income last year, $7.3 million without having a job, and the reporters rushed there, and everybody was mad that they just got 1 hour and they couldn't take photos, I thought, well, you know what, I better disclose my taxes too. So I put it out there, I called all the reporters and all the networks with my $62,000 family income, one pager, and no one showed up. Nobody looked at it. We are really just fascinated with wealth. We're fascinated, we hate it and we love it at the same time. And I just think that yes, it needs to be disclosed. We especially need to know if the money being made by the candidate is completely out of line with statements being said about cares and concerns for the world. I think the biggest area to look at is fracking and environmental related issues, because those are easy to find on the current Democrat candidate, that there's problems there. So yes, I think full disclosure is important. I could have brought mine and we could be done with the conversation.
Thank you, sir. And then finally, this is actually a three-part question. It has to do with immigration. What would your administration do to protect immigrants and minority rights, religious tolerance, including Muslim rights? So that's the first part.
So as soon as the what looked like a registration might be considered back in the fall, I wrote a letter saying that I would register as a Muslim if such a registration happened. I've lived through the hell of a Muslim registration from 2002, the NSEERS program, the National Registration Entry and Exit Security Program, which aimed at Muslims from the 24 largest countries in the world. Males ages 15 to 65 had to go report or be considered terrorist fugitives. And that's actually the program that's left all the Indonesian Christians in my life caught up in this dragnet. So it's bad for everyone whenever we, you know, select people out because of their religion. It's just the most wrong and heinous thing I could possibly imagine. I'm very involved in interfaith work, both with refugees and asylees, and so that I can tell you very clearly. What were the other parts of that question?
What would you do to promote religious tolerance, including Muslim rights, minority rights, and what would you do to protect immigrants?
Yeah, so 500,000 people in New Jersey are undocumented. And to me, they are residents of New Jersey. They are citizens of this world called New Jersey. And they need to be protected and honored. And they're last right now. And their families are really last. The amount of emotional stress that I am experiencing in my congregation, kids who can't sleep at night, parents who are making plans for what to do, it's just disgusting. It's the closest thing I can think of to racial and ethnic cleansing of anything I've ever heard in my life. As governor, I would stand strong against the president. I have to tell you, tomorrow morning at 4:15, I'll be going to Elizabeth Detention Center like I did last Monday at 4:15 to stand in the road and just have one morning where ICE can't have people go away without a fight from church people. 2 days a week, we go and visit detainees at the same detention center, push for their release, and then help house them when they get out. I would also, if I was governor, on a weekly basis, I would find some way to read the names, if permitted, or the profiles, if not the names, of families that have been broken up by the policies of Donald Trump during that week. And it would be sort of in the spirit of Oscar Romero, the Archbishop of El Salvador, who would read the names of those who had been murdered. And just with the mindset of saying, we need to expose the horrific behavior of our federal government. And maybe we can't stop them completely. We'll try our best to stop them through some of the ways I mentioned earlier. But when we can't stop them, we will apologize on behalf of our country to families that have been broken up, and we will work to make sure that this never happens again.
So can I safely assume that you would make New Jersey a fair and welcoming state?
I would not use the word fair and welcoming, and I've had many fights with Joanna Kaye about this at the Immigrant Network. I believe that we should be a sanctuary state. I think fair and welcoming is too broad in this particular moment. Yes, I'm concerned about all the categories of people that fall under concerns of fair and welcoming. But at this moment, there's an attack going on immigrant families, and the word that they understand is sanctuary. I've had some mayors say to me, well, but that'll confuse people. They'll think if they're in your town, in your sanctuary town, that they're safe from ICE. And no, these are smart people. They know that that's not the case. But they want to hear the words. They want to hear the word sanctuary and to know firmly that we stand on the side of protection, and we're going to become more and more creative about what the theatrics of love look like, what the pushback will be in order to keep people safe.
Thank you so much. So that concludes our prepared questions. Now I'd like to open the floor to anyone from the audience who has a question or comment for Mr. Seth Kaper-Dale. And please make your questions brief, because again, he has a schedule. Thank you so much. Yes, Shoma.
My question is very brief. I'm not quite sure if the answer is going to be brief. My question is that, to me, being a third-party candidate, whatever that third-party is almost like a self-perpetuating, you know, way to failure to me. I'm sorry to say this, but how do you convince people that you are going to win so that they vote for you? Because ultimately, we want somebody, you know, to win who is not representing Donald Trump's policies.
So if you're only concerned about Donald Trump's policies and not the policies of the two-party duopoly, I'm not sure you're going to like my answer. I am not somebody who says that Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump are two sides of the same coin. I never say that kind of thing. The families in our communities would be safer if Hillary Clinton was president right now. So please don't misunderstand me when I say this. This is a particularly heinous moment in our country. What I want to say is that most of the people in New Jersey are not Democrats and Republicans. Most people in New Jersey are independents. And I really don't care about trying to convince bourgeois Democrats that I am their choice. Folks are going to have to decide if what they want is soft liberal reforms or if they want a revolution. If they want a revolution, they can make that decision if they're going to line up with me or not. But I am spending my time going out to communities that are not sought out by Republicans. I really want to win those who aren't in the two-party system. And I'm not going to spend time looking through the 500 responses to every Facebook post about how I'm going to split the vote or any of that. I'm not concerned about that at all. Folks can figure it out. There's a tiny number of people in the state. 39% of the people in the state voted in the last gubernatorial election. 61% didn't vote. So I'm going after the 61, and I believe that if I can make significant strides in the ground game to reach the 61, maybe some of those who are within the Democratic Party, who aren't believers yet that a progressive can actually get somewhere, they'll be like, man, he's got 13%. Maybe we could make a difference, and maybe he'll jump on over. That's what I'm hoping for. But I'm not going to start by trying to get the choir to, you know, to change camps. I'm starting by going for those who aren't in a camp.
I think we had a question over here.
Yeah.
So I'm an educator, teaching East Orange, I'm a member of the NJBA, and I've got hundreds of eyeballs on me every day. I'm curious about what you have to say to the education sector, both from the labor organizing perspective as well as the curriculum perspective. what's your vision for education in a very comprehensive way?
So the first thing I would say is all teachers in New Jersey need a gigantic apology for the last 8 years and for the way that elected officials in this state, and I'm saying officials, first the governor has been a jerk, right? So we just need to apologize to the governor. But we also have to apologize for wealthy Republicans and Democrats alike who have pushed TARP and pushed all sorts of testing into the school system as if they know what they're talking about with education. And they've done it for a profit motive most of the time. There's a lot of money to be made off pushing this type of way of living out education, and I think it's offensive. We need to stop that entirely, and we have to name that it's not just a Republican thing. In fact, most of the money came from people like Bill Gates, and we need to name that this has been what's led us down the road to hyper-testing and really made a lot of teachers question whether they are in the field that they thought they were wanting to be in. So those are some of the first things I'd say. In terms of labor, I want labor unions to be super strong. I want to become the governor who encourages unionization and who does not fear unionization, but believes that if labor has is taken seriously and if labor actually sets the pace, we'd be a better state. So I'm much more interested in workers shaping this world than in the bosses shaping this world. And that's true of teachers, and it's true of other sectors as well.
I think I saw another hand. Do we have any additional questions? Elizabeth?
I need a microphone. First of all, thank you so much. I just appreciate teachers so much right now. And before I even get to my question, there's a West Orange Board of Ed meeting tomorrow night at 8 at the high school. We have a very anti-teacher superintendent right now, so any West Orange residents can come out. But thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate all the work that you do. And I guess my question is kind of a ground game question. As an organization that has tried to do and succeeded to a point, not to the point that your congregation has, but has tried to do a lot of the, on a smaller scale, programs that you've done through your church, I just am interested if there's just a few, and I wish we had hours to get information from you about this, but I know Shoma and I are on refugee relief through Essex Rising, and I would just appreciate any tips you have on kind of making things seem possible. These ideas, because we have this great organization of more than 1,000 people. People come up with these exciting ideas. We always want to support them. But if you can just give us some specific advice on community grassroots organizing, because a lot of us are newer to this than you are. So
I'll just tell you about the two most recent things I've formed. One is Interfaith Rise, Interfaith Refugee and Immigrant Services and Empowerment.
Okay.
This started at the end of 2015 when we were seeing the pictures of people drowning in the Mediterranean, and when we were seeing the pictures coming out of Syria, and we just felt like we needed to do something for refugees. So we started forming a committee, which we called the Take 10 Campaign. We were encouraging every town in our area to take 10 refugees into their community. It was dreamy, it was ambitious. We had no idea how the system worked and how hard it was to actually get people, but we jumped in, we started raising money, and our first event happened to be 2 days before Chris Christie said, no Syrians, not even under the age of 5. So we became very much in the media because we were the resistance to that kind of attitude. Within 10 months, we are now a State Department-approved refugee resettlement site. We have 50 people a year coming in through Interfaith Rise, which has a headquarters in our congregation. We've hired a case manager. We've started an ESL school. We have a vocational expert. And we've created a restaurant which employs folks as they come in while they begin to find other jobs and work full time. So that's happened in a year. And it's a combination of dreaming and then like really getting on the ground about the details of what it takes to go from like a good idea to a pragmatic first step. And the biggest thing I'd say is like just jump. Like jump in to the idea and don't be afraid. I think anxiety stops so many good dreams.
Right.
And we always jump in. My statement that I always say to my kids and to my church is take a beat. Like,
right.
We're such, like, we sonic about being perfect.
Right.
Just take a beat and jump in. And what you find is that no one else is actually doing it. They're all trying to, but they haven't jumped.
Right.
So jump and it'll, there's a good chance you're going to land on your feet.
And are there links to all of these programs on your website?
Interfaithrise.org is the website for that one. The second one is called DIRE. This is Deportation and Immigration Response Equipo, which we didn't call the Deportation and Immigration Response Team, because that would be dirt. DIRE was much truer to what we were saying. These are dire times. And DIRE is set up to be an emergency response, like a protection organization, and it's working. We have a phone number where if people call this emergency number, which we are distributing throughout New Brunswick and Edison and other places, if they call this number, seven people's phones ring simultaneous. Whoever picks it up first, in English and in Spanish, can speak with them. If it's another language, we have a list of other languages available. You might say, someone's knocking on our door, or my brother just got taken to the detention center, or whatever, and then we respond. The person who answers the phone can click a button on WhatsApp and send out a message to 256 of us who are on the list, who can rush to the scene of something that's going down. So that, we're all set up to do that. We have all the numbers in place. And we haven't had an opportunity yet to get to a door before ICE did their damage. But the fact that it exists is part of the theatrics of love. And it's something real. We have been able to stop a few cases. I won't get into them now, but none of them were in the moment. But we do other things too. So we accompany people to their appointments. Many people have to go to 970 Broad Street, which is a terrifying thing, because they're on some sort of a final deportation order with this I-246 stay of removal. So we plan always to have people go as accompaniers. If someone does get detained, we plan rallies, we plan ways to support families. So that's what DIRE is. And that these have been the best interfaith projects I've ever worked on in my life, because right now, people just know that they need to come together in resistance.
Right. Yes, Gary and Silver.
Yesterday, some of us were in a committee with some representatives from Our Revolution, the Bernie and Spillof group, and their ideas too are very close to the principles of Essex Rising. And their philosophy, of course, is that one has to take over the statewide democratic apparatus from the grassroots up. And they feel that that's the only way to take over New Jersey. So from your perspective, how much light or air do you see between these two positions, and where do you see the pragmatics between those two?
So the funny thing, I'm from Vermont. I spent the first 18 years of my life in Vermont. My dad was the commissioner of the Department of Children and Families, and we had interactions with Bernie regularly when he was with mayor. Bernie is not a Democrat. Bernie was never a Democrat. He was outside. He only jumped into the party because that was the most pragmatic way to do it last year. So it cracks me up to hear people act as if the Bernie way is somehow to take over the party. Last year it was, but that's not the way he's played ball forever. So I question that a lot. If they can take over the party, God bless them. I hope that they're able to do that. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's the way to go right now. I really don't think it's the way to go. In the state of New Jersey, at least, we are so corrupt. We've had people in place longer than Castro was in Cuba. We've had the same party bosses running these the counties in this state. So at some point, you're going to have to just I think break free, maybe come back at some point, but really twist things up. Because what happens every time is that at the end we wimp out and we go back to choosing to go with Phil Murphy or some variation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So the greenfield approach is easier than it's easier to build something from scratch than to take a 1990 Honda and try to turn it into a modern car.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you rather just build a new car? Or take one that was built maybe a couple years ago that's welcoming you and it was designed to be upgraded? It's kind of like when you buy a computer. You can buy one that's designed to put in more memory, designed to put in a bigger hard drive. And the Green Party is designed to be flexible right now.
Thank you for that.
Yeah.
So, a lot of the things that you talked about, you reference churches and you know some place of worship. Would you extend the same amount of you know welcoming nature or policies towards people who do not, let's say, practice any religion or do not, you know, operate within the realm of some religion?
Thanks for the question. Yeah, first of all, I would just say clearly, if I become governor of the state, I'm no longer pastor of any church. Like, this is what I'm doing, is being governor. I'm not going to try to wear multiple hats. And yes, the answer is yes. Anywhere where people care about making the earth shine with, you know, common love and peace and all the things that we care about, and making sure that there's that human rights are the focus, yeah, that's who's going to get my attention. Not at all specifically tied to any particular faith community or faith at all. Yeah.
My question would be, as far as in your campaign platform, you say that you want to provide more affordable housing. How will you go about making that happen in New Jersey?
So there's a program called Build a Thriving New Jersey that's been put in place by a collaborative of affordable housing groups in the state, and they show that there's easily the possibility for $600 million a year to be committed toward affordable housing and all of the infrastructure that it takes to support affordable housing. I'm interested very much in knowing the ins and outs about that plan, Building a Thriving New Jersey. So some of it would be for different tax credit projects, some of it would be by supporting nonprofit developers. There will be a lot of different programs out there. The Special Needs Housing Trust Fund is the program that allowed my nonprofit development organization to start up. There was $200 million put in that fund when we had Richard Cody become governor, which, by the way, he was unelected two times and put more money toward poor people than any elected governor. So it tells us something about how well voting works, I think. But he really did. $200 million in the Special Needs Trust Fund, it was a new idea by him, specifically housing for youth aging out of foster care, homeless veterans, folks coming out of jail, chronically homeless mentally ill adults, and single moms with kids. That was what it was. And so there's money there already, and many of the pieces of that $600 million are already supposed to be coming in through surcharges on different programs that exist in the state already, and they just have continually gotten stripped away and put into the general fund for years. So we're going to stop doing that. And also, single-payer healthcare is going to save so much money that we should have plenty of money for housing.
I'm just going to bring it up because it hasn't come up yet. And I think it's this is largely a commuter community, not largely, but there's a big chunk of it that is. And our public transportation system is, as everybody knows, is underwater. It's total liability, right? It's been disinvested in for 20, 30 years.
Yeah.
How would you make it? How do you think you get the state on the path of making it an actual asset? And make it something that people want to use, you get, you know, getting cars off the road.
Yeah. So I think it needs to be tied in to many of the big things I've already talked about. So public bank, I believe, is a real asset for new projects that need to have funds coming from somewhere. And if public transportation was a central way that we used money coming into the public bank, we would have a whole new source of money to help public transportation. The other thing is the REGI agreements, the Regional Energy Greenhouse Gas Initiative. That was set in place specifically to help states make renewable energy changes. And part of that has to do with transit, big time. And it's to say that there's a tax on carbon. And what, you know, Christie decided that was bad for New Jersey, and we've watched the nine other states that stayed in that agreement make hundreds of millions of dollars, I think in some states over $1 billion during this time that we've not been participating. That money could be largely directed to a transportation. So those are a couple of the ways I do it. And I think that progressive taxation and money saved through single payer healthcare, all these things are going to create new assets in our state that we haven't seen before in a long time.
I'm wondering if you have an idea idea how long it would take to get single-payer health care enacted? And once it's enacted, how long would the transition period be? And in the meantime, well, they might be, you know, ACA might be repealed and things like that. Do you have a transitional strategy between the time, you know, like from the day you get elected, where you could maybe do something like what Nevada is doing, where they've just extended Medicaid to anybody who needs it with no income limits? Or, you know, what can we do as a state, as a measure until we get single payer?
So, like, Medicaid as a public option is basically what they have done in Nevada, right?
They're basically allowing anybody to sign into it.
Right.
And so I think they actually are charging, you're right. I think they do have, depending on your income level, you could buy into Medicaid.
Right. So I think what I would say is, first, I don't have the answer to that, and it's something I need to work towards to figure out what a transition period would look like. So that's my honest answer. But secondly, Band-Aids will have to be put in place. Obamacare is a Band-Aid and not a very good one. And if we can come up with a better Band-Aid, as long as we don't accept Band-Aids as acceptable. So if we do make a move toward a Nevada model, let's not become overly excited about it and think, well, now we've come up with a new way to keep blessing the health insurance industry to be involved in things. Because the health insurance industry will find a way to benefit from any model that's other than the single-payer Medicare for all. That's my answer.
Do we have any additional questions or comments?
Yes, Rose. Only because I have to say something. Hi. I must say thank you for coming. I was kind of hesitant about coming today, but I do appreciate everything you said. I gave a lot of food for thought. And my concern has always been, and I've said this to my colleagues and peers here, is where do we go? I don't want a day that I've had in November of 2016 after Election Day. Probably was feeling before that too, right? Because I'm still sick to my stomach. So my goal is, if I do anything, I want to feel like I will win, not just be a revolution, unless the revolution is actually a true revolution to win. So how do we truly do that, right? And how do we truly support you in that sense so that we actually have something that's much more robust than what we have today and truly get people to be that inspired?
So I guess my answer to that would be you've got to decide whether you want to jump in and take a beat right now, and like I was saying earlier, and try to live into a better future, if you want to wait and see whether I have any shot at all, and then come along for the ride, and then support us getting there. And I'm comfortable with whatever your answer is, and that's true with everybody. It is a lot to ask. It is an uphill battle, and whether or not you in your particular moment feel like it's one you want to be fully part of, that's a, you know, a personal choice that people have to make. But the time and energy of our campaign is into the ground game in every community in the state of New Jersey. Our plan right now is 900 events in 90 days. We are every single day making sure that there are 10 events happening starting June 15th in 10 different high population regions. An event might be somebody in a car for 3 hours going out and meeting 200 people. That's as small as it can be. We want at least, I should say 100 people. At least 100 people as a touch point in 10 different regions every single day. Our goal is in 90 days to get to 150,000 to 200,000 people directly and hope that they then talk to the people that they know. That's the way we're doing it. We're going neighborhood by neighborhood. Yesterday we went all up and down Hawthorne Avenue on the Irvington and Newark border. And when we were about down around Riverside Park and Ironbound section, we are going to make sure that there's a tremendous amount of touch points with the people of New Jersey. And that's the way we're going to do it. So 900 events in 90 days. My hope is that by the time we hit September 15th, we can do 900 events in 30 days. That we've created so much more of a groundswell that we have more and more people who are committed, so that we might have 10 people in every region going out and saying, today I'll be one of the 10 in Essex County who's going to be going around and pushing for this movement. So that's, we have a ground game, and it's really a ground game. We'll buy some commercials, we'll you know, if you support us financially, copperdaleforgovernor.com. I finally said it. Or you know, of course that helps, and money's important. If I don't raise $430,000, I'm not in the debates in the fall. I want to be in those debates. We've raised something like 70-ish thousand right now, which is not a lot of money, but it's not nothing. We're pretty proud of that. It's the most that the Greens have raised for a campaign probably ever in the state of New Jersey. So we feel good that we're moving in the right direction financially. We hope to be in those debates, but to be honest, I would just love to get to hundreds of thousands of people, you know, door to door and person to person through a system that's growing and moving, and that's where the real revolution is going to happen.
How close are you to getting the 90,000 for the debates?
No, I have to have 430,000. I have 70,000.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's going to take a lot to get there.
What's the timeline for that? The deadline?
August 31st.
So can we host fundraisers?
You
would
can
that
host
be a
fundraisers.
Way to help you?
The rest of the day today, I'll be going to a dessert party tonight, and it's constant. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's constant. And also, we have a crowd pack. I don't know what that is. So we've set up a crowd pack as a way to, instead of a super pack, it's a crowd pack. So that we can get the crowd to all be participating. It's an online way to deal.
Does the party help you? I mean, will the Green Party help you get that money together to be in the debate?
So the Green Party locally is already helping us. It's a pretty small party, but they're doing good work to support our campaign. One of the best things they've done is they've convinced the National Green Party to have their annual convention in Newark, July 13th through 16th, specifically as a form of support for my candidacy. I mean, there's only two gubernatorial races in the country this year, Virginia and New Jersey, and I'm the only Green governor candidate. So it makes sense that they be here, and we hope that they'll put their energy into raising funds for us.
Right.
So we expect it. We've had very good interaction with John Mubaraka, who I think is an amazing individual, and I would like to see, you know, him come out and support us financially by putting in a good word, and I fully expect he will.
Do you have any, for like phone banking, any resources for directly contacting unregistered voters, or not unregistered, but
Yeah, Jeff has put most of the time into that.
Yeah, but one way, I mean, I would suggest, I mean, like, because Seth is going to have to leave in about 15 minutes, and as we discussed earlier, we could still continue to talk about some campaign-related stuff. I'm just saying, so why don't we talk about that in a couple of minutes in case there's any other specific things for Seth?
Because he does have the answers to those questions, specifics about phone banking.
I don't have a question. I just want to make a comment that somebody has to raise a certain amount of money to be in a debate is
a problem.
Yes.
That's a problem.
Yeah. So, and every year, the elected officials in place up that dollar figure. It goes up a lot. I can't remember what it was 8 years ago, but it was.
It shuts people out.
Well, that's the goal.
Yeah. I mean, that is their goal.
I'm going to write the film work and have him write you
a check. There you go.
You won't miss it. You won't miss it.
The whole lot.
So, I mean, if you want a progressive voice in November, I'm the only progressive voice that will be there in November in the gubernatorial race. Whether or not we can pull it off, that's going to be how well we run our ground game. But I think the voice matters, and we fully expect to win. I wouldn't be trying, but I think we could win.
And on that note, unless there is any additional questions for Mr. Copperdale, do we have any additional questions, comments? Thank you so much, Mr. Copperdale. It was an honor to have you here in the first part of our series of progressive talks. Let me just mention an aside, please support the cafe right across the hall there. They have let us use their space for free. We are using their electricity, their space, everything, their chairs, for 100% free. They're a wonderful group of people, so please support the art group being right across the way. Thank you so much. We do hope that we have educated you all so that when you go to the polls in November, you know what your options are. And Elizabeth, is there anything that you would like to mention about Essex Rising's upcoming events?
Just that Board of Ed meeting tomorrow night is really important because the contract renewal is coming up for a